There's something strange about this theme park in Western Germany. It has a carousel, a roller coaster, and a cooling tower. That's because it sits on the grounds of an abandoned nuclear reactor. And this nuclear reactor was quite different from the ones we know today. It promised something almost unfathomable. While using nuclear fuel, it was supposed to make more of it. And this wasn't the only reactor designed to do this.
EBR-2 can manufacture more fuel than it burns.
The Enrico Fermi Atomic Power Plant.
But look around today, and these reactors are almost nowhere to be seen. The one in Germany never ran for a single second. Which might be a real shame, because they also promised to take care of nuclear energy's unsolved problem, nuclear waste. Yep, exactly the stuff that we currently just have sitting around because we don't know what to do with it. So why did we give up on this nuclear technology? And can we bring it back? This story really begins here, in 1951, in the middle of the desert in Idaho.
These very motion pictures were taken with electrical power from the EBR, the first motion picture cameras ever driven by the product of nuclear energy.
Producing electricity wasn't the only thing that earned this reactor a place in the history books. It also managed to make that new fuel I mentioned in the process. Nuclear scientists call this breeding.
A phenomenon of obvious importance to the long-term future of atomic energy.
From the very beginning of nuclear, we thought breeders were really the long-term future.
This is Nick Turan, a nuclear engineer who has designed reactors for over a decade.
So it really was thought that like no reactor will ever make any sense at all at commercial scale unless it's a breeder. The reason was, at the time, we thought there was very little uranium on Earth, nuclear fuel.
Now's the point where we quickly have to brush up on our physics. A piece of natural uranium like this contains largely two different types of uranium atoms.
Uranium-238 and uranium-235.
Uranium-235 is great to use in a reactor, because if it gets hit by a neutron, it splits easily. This releases energy as heat, and it sets more neutrons free.
Driven out with tremendous speed.
These new neutrons then split other U-235 atoms, setting more neutrons free.
The result? A chain reaction.
The heat this chain reaction produces can be used to generate steam that drives a turbine that makes electricity. Whereas when a neutron hits a U-238 atom,
it may be captured and thus absorbed into the atom.
But no splitting means no energy release. The problem is that only 0.7% of all natural uranium is that useful kind, the U-235. Almost the entire rest is that unsplittable U-238. Finding a way to squeeze energy out of this would massively stretch the world's reserves.
Would you say that using the 235 and not the rest is sort of like using the cream and throwing away the milk?
Exactly.
And that was the point of the reactors we saw before, fast reactors.
You're just converting stuff that doesn't start out as fuel or good fuel into good usable fuel.
Inside them, neutrons are flying around at high speeds. The U-238 captures these and then changes.
First to neptunium, then to plutonium.
And this, plutonium, splits easily. So you can take it out of the reactor, chemically process it, and turn it into more fuel. Quite a few reactors of this type were built. But almost all of them have since shut down or were never started up like the one in Germany. While hundreds of other slow reactors are up and running all over the world. So what happened?
There's a couple of things that happened that really dampened the prospects for breeder reactors.
Paul Wilson is a nuclear engineer who builds computer models that help us better understand developments in nuclear power.
One of them was a growing concern in the late 1970s about the proliferation of nuclear weapons.
Because this can be made with
plutonium.
The very stuff you'd pull out of a breeder reactor and separate out to make more fuel. There were fears this could fall into the wrong hands.
That played a huge factor in stopping many of the programs kind of around the world.
In Germany, like elsewhere, people protested, which played its part in that reactor from earlier never entering into operation. It was officially declared discontinued in 1991, by which point it had racked up billions in costs. In the US, then-President Jimmy Carter halted a big fast reactor project in 1977, citing the growing threat of nuclear weapons.
There was a great concern for having a plutonium economy. And so this was a policy shift that really had a big impact in the United States.
Other countries, like France and Japan, were willing to take that proliferation risk. Russia still has two fairly large fast reactors running. But another reason they've all but disappeared elsewhere is how they're designed. They rely on what Nick calls
exotic coolants.
The regular reactors in use today use water as a coolant to remove and carry heat away from the core. Water also slows down the neutrons given off from splitting atoms, making it much more likely they'll hit and split other U-235 atoms. But
to breed, you want to keep your neutrons moving fast?
That's why fast reactors use liquid metals as a coolant, most commonly sodium. It keeps neutrons moving fast, and fast neutrons are way better at converting U-238. But sodium's a lot harder to handle than water, as we learned the hard way.
Maybe the one at the sort of worst end of experience was Manju in Japan.
This video only surfaced years later, but it was shot in 1995, just 1 year after this reactor started up. Sodium had leaked out of one of the pipes, and that's bad news.
When sodium comes in contact with water, it's got a violent reaction.
Even air can hold enough water to trigger that violent reaction. After the accident, the reactor was shut down for almost 15 years. The Superphénix, the biggest fast reactor ever built, didn't trigger a big accident. But small technical problems, including a snow-covered roof that collapsed, meant it was getting fixed more than it was running. All this led operating costs for these types of reactors to shoot up. Also, there turned out to be more uranium than people had feared back in the day. Mining and enriching fresh U-235 has proven cheaper than breeding and processing fuel from U-238. All this led to the shutdown of most fast reactors. But some say they're overdue for a comeback, for two big reasons. The first one?
Climate change
became a major issue, and nuclear can make 24/7 electricity and heat without emitting hardly any CO2.
While nuclear power generation grew pretty steadily over the second half of the 20th century, it's plateaued since the start of the 2000s. Some say we need to start pushing it again to counteract climate change. At the 2023 COP climate conference, the goal was set to triple capacity by 2050.
And if we were going to see people started saying like, okay, we're going to start building hundreds of nuclear plants again, well, that will challenge the world's uranium resources and fuel costs will start going up. And then the really key capability of breeders to get so much more energy out of that fuel will start to make sense.
China started up a demonstration reactor in low power mode for testing and is constructing a second one. And India says it has started loading fuel into the prototype reactor it began building in 2004. It should be operational by the end of 2025. Both countries say this is to make better use of their own resources and achieve energy independence. Private companies are getting in on the action too, with some pretty big names involved.
Nuclear really is special.
Bill Gates founded TerraPower, which has broken ground on a fast reactor. They claim it's more efficient than regular reactors and could power hundreds of thousands of homes. But there's a second reason for bringing back fast reactors. Because along with breeding more fuel, they can help us solve another problem, managing nuclear waste.
It's only waste if you waste it.
This is Paul Goutet, CTO of the French nuclear company Exana. They're developing a fast reactor which aims to provide heat to heavy industry. It's to run on depleted fuel from other reactors.
In conventional reactors, you use enriched uranium, so it means a lot of uranium to mine, to convert, to enrich. In our case, we recycle the fuel from others. If you have fast reactor, sodium fast reactor, you can reuse this fuel a lot of time.
We are already recycling fuel that can then be reused in conventional reactors, as the biggest company doing this showcases here. But fast reactors, because they are better at splitting the plutonium it contains, are way better at using it. The Superphénix, for example, ran on recycled fuel.
It's not a legend. We managed to recycle this fuel. But at the end, you have always waste. that is important to understand.
But the radiotoxicity of the waste that does come out is also less long-lived. Instead of tens of thousands of years, we might only have to store it a few hundred until it falls back to safe levels. The promise here is huge. Today, very simply speaking, we use nuclear fuel like this. We mine and process it, use it in a reactor, and then store the radioactive waste. But a lot of potential energy gets wasted here, and fast reactors could be the key to changing that. First of all, they can be used to breed more fuel from the start, so we could mine less uranium. And at the end, they can recycle the spent fuel several times, with less waste needing to go into storage. If fast reactors become a thing, they could be a real game changer.
Presumably, we will see changes in our need to mine uranium, and we will see changes in the amount of material that we imagine storing underground. If we do get there, there's a lot of promise.
But, well, that if is pretty big. Because this may look great in theory, but to make spent fuel usable in another reactor, you need to chemically reprocess it and then turn it into fuel pellets again, which is a major pain.
When you extract that plutonium, it takes a lot of care in handling because it comes with a lot of radioactive species as well, and so it's not as simple as making fuel, fresh fuel for conventional reactors.
Digging up uranium, fabricating it, running it in a reactor, and just storing it in the parking lot is like a lot cheaper than reprocessing.
Unless this reprocessing becomes a lot cheaper, or prices for fresh uranium unexpectedly shoot up, there's little incentive to change the way we're doing things. There are also just a handful of reprocessing facilities worldwide. We'd have to build up a whole industry for this, along with more fast reactors.
Exana alone cannot close the fuel cycle. At the end, you need large fast reactor to get rid of uranium mining, uranium enrichment, and to make this kind of circular economy a reality at the end.
And all this takes time. Nuclear reactors can take ages to build. XNR wants to have their first one up and running by 2035, if everything goes to plan. But even once reactors are built, we'd still be a long way off from breeding and reusing at scale.
The transition to get there, particularly if relying on existing used nuclear fuel stocks, is a century-long transition.
But we need clean energy, and lots of it, kind of like yesterday. And there's still the looming threat of bad actors getting their hands on all the separated plutonium this would produce. So, should we just give up on fast reactors?
I think there's a few hurdles. It doesn't mean we shouldn't do it.
After all, making nuclear energy more efficient is a vision worth pursuing, as long as it doesn't distract us from already deploying technologies that are proven and cheap. Had you ever heard about this almost forgotten type of nuclear reactor? And do you think we should bring it back? Let us know in the comments and head to dw.com for more information.